Good day. Last time we kicked off the series on our micro-FPV drone tuning guide, we established a baseline tune using RPM filters and the PID tuning sliders of Betaflight 4.2 for our 3-inch micro-FPV quadcopter Rattler build. If you missed that video, I'd recommend you stop this one and check it out through the micro-FPV drone tuning guide playlist link in the video description below. As I mentioned last time, if you're just learning how to fly FPV, I do not recommend doing any PID or filter tuning with your default bind-and-fly quadcopter setup, as long as it seems to be working out okay for you. Just focus on learning to fly and having a blast. I would encourage you to check out some of my other videos in the Learn FPV playlist linked in the video description below, such as this one on FPV beginner tips, and also the Fast Track FPV course, which will get you in the air having fun flying FPV in minimal time, at less overall cost, and in a safe and responsible manner. This video today is the second in our series, and we'll start where we left off last time with our baseline tune. We took it out on a flight last time, and it looked like it performed well. The motors didn't get too hot, and it seemed fairly responsive. Didn't notice through the flight video much, if any, prop wash, vibrations, or bounce back. Today we'll take a closer look at that baseline tune and see how it actually performs through the use of a great little software application tool provided to us again for free by the Betaflight devs called Blackbox Log Viewer, or Blackbox Explorer. You can support further development of this tool and Betaflight in general through a link in the video description below. The name Blackbox Explorer may sound mysterious or intimidating, but today I'm going to show you it's really not. In fact, the Blackbox Log Viewer is really going to turn out to be one of your best friends. I'll quickly go over its installation, how to set it up in Betaflight, explain the concept of a Blackbox Log, and go over some of its basics, which you can use to get more out of your micro-FPV drone tuning process for better performance and smoother flights. I'll apply those basics to our micro-FPV drone tune of our 3-inch quadcopter build to see if we can improve upon its baseline tune. This micro-FPV drone tuning process I go through is included in this checklist, which you can download through a link in the video description below. This is not the only way to tune an FPV drone. This is the simplest way I tune mine. Sound good? Then give this video a thumbs up below, share it with at least one of your friends to help them out, and subscribe to your TMAC FPV channel, your home for your journey to better FPV fun, flights, and racing stuff. As a recap from last time, these are the filter settings we used to include the gyro RPM filters. And these are the PID settings we used for our baseline by moving the master multiplier slider to the left to the 0.8 position. As I mentioned in the intro, on our first test flight, it seemed to fly good and the motor temps seemed to be fine. To see how it actually performed, though, we need to look at the actual flight data. We do that through the flight data recorder, which I'm sure you've heard of before.
Investigators have reviewed the flight data recorder and they say that black box indicates...
It's the same sort of thing that's used on passenger aircraft, called the black box. The flight data recorded by the black box is called the black box log. That's why our little software application is called Black Box Log Viewer. Of course, to look at this flight performance data, we need to have a black box on our micro-FPV quad. Keep in mind, not all flight controllers do. So if you want to be able to use this feature of recording flight information, you'll want to get a flight controller with black box capability. I'm going to show you a couple examples of good micro-FPV flight controllers I've used with that capability. This one is the Diatone Mamba F722 Mini. This is where its black box is located. And one thing I also want to point out is this chip here, which is your MPU6000 accelerometer gyro. Keep this in mind for later, because this is the device which is sensing your actual flight data, which gets stored on your black box chip. This one is the Flywoo Goku F722 Mini. Both of these have a flash memory on them, as do most 20x20 flight controllers, as opposed to what some 30x30 stacks for larger quads have, which is an SD card. Links to both of these flight controllers with black box capability for your micro FPV quads are in the video description below. Now that you have a flight controller with black box capability, let's quickly set that capability up in Betaflight. We connect to Betaflight. And if you haven't already done so, enable expert mode over here. It's not necessary with Betaflight 4.2 to display your black box tab. However, it will display other tabs over here, which are not shown without it. Click on black box, toggle on onboard flash, assuming you've got a 20x20 flight controller or an all-in-one flight controller with an onboard flash chip. Click on 1 kHz, and we want to select gyro scale.
which is what I mentioned earlier when I was pointing out the gyro on the MPU-6000. I'll explain why we select this later on. Click Save and Reboot. And we just have one more step to activate this capability. Go to the Modes tab, scroll down to Black Box, and click Add Range. We need to select here the aux channel corresponding to the channel which we've set up in our mixer page. In my case, on my transmitter mixes page, I'm using channel 12 and put black box on switch G. Channel 12 is auxiliary channel 8 because channels 1 through 4 are designated for your control signal channels. So since I've selected aux 8, I go down here and I pick aux 8. I'm going to slide this slider over here, and then when I flip switch G, this little yellow marker will come over here and be activated. We always want to click Save anytime we make any changes within Betaflight. So we click Save. Some people like to activate black box by using the same switch as their arming switch, which I've got here on aux 1. I don't, simply because I don't want to record all of my flights to the onboard flash memory, because it's going to fill it up unnecessarily. I only want to record my flight data when I'm doing tuning, so I put it on a separate switch. We want to click Save. So now we have flight data recorder or black box capability set up in both our transmitter and in Betaflight to record our flight performance info anytime we flip the switch when we arm our quad. The info is then going to get saved to your flight controller, that black box chip we pointed out earlier, which we can then download the file from there. To download our file, we connect our quad to Betaflight and go to the black box tab that we were at earlier. Click Activate Mass Storage Device Mode. And this will show your onboard flash as a drive on your computer. Simply go to that drive and access the file associated with your flight, which is usually numbered sequentially, with the highest number being the last one recorded. Click on that file and save it to a folder on your computer you've created for where you want to save your flight data files. Once that file is saved to a folder on your computer, you can either erase the files from flash memory or simply disconnect your quad from Betaflight, depending upon how much of this flash memory is used up. Before we can view the flight data, though, we need to install the Black Box Log Viewer. We do that by going to this site, take a look at which file you need. In my case, I'm using Windows 10, so I'm going to use this Explorer Installer win32.exe. It also has some release notes associated with it. So we just scroll down here to the file that you need. I click on this one and we download it to our computer. It's downloading over here. Once it's downloaded, I'm going to cut and paste it to a folder which I've already created on my computer. Paste it to that folder. And then we simply double click on this to initiate the install process. And finish. Now that we've got the viewer installed, we can open it up and grab our flight data file or the black box log. We do that by clicking on Open Log File or Video and double click on the black box log file we just saved. A screen similar to this one will show up. On this main screen, we'll see a map of our flight data, which we'll get to shortly. Across the bottom is a timeline of our flight data, which we can scroll through by either holding the left mouse button down and dragging the main screen, or dragging this red bar down here on our timeline. Up at the top, we have a few menu or control buttons. This is your home button. Click on this little eye, and it shows you what your PID and filter settings are for that particular flight, which can be useful. If you click on this where it says View Table, and I'm hesitant to do so because it can get messy, but it'll display stuff you see currently in a graphical format in the format of a table. This actually can be quite useful when you really want to get into the details of something and see the specific values of it. We're not going to do that today. Here you can turn on and off your quadcopter display and your sticks display. This turns on and off what's called your analyzer display here, or a spectrum of amplitude versus frequency. You can also blow the spectrum up by clicking in the upper right-hand corner. These are your normal play, back, and forward buttons for your file displayed. You can control the speed at which it's played and zoom out with these buttons. This is the time at which this vertical red line is positioned in our flight, which again can be important if you're looking at something specifically and can also be useful if you're looking to sync up your flight data file with your flight video from your goggles DVR or HD camera. Over here we have our Tools button, which you can use to position various things on your screen, like your sticks and quadcopter displays, as well as other settings. I found a very useful button to be this question mark over here, which shows you some shortcut keys available to you like M and Alt M to synchronize your flight videos with your flight data log, as I mentioned earlier. This over here on the right is your legend of what is currently being displayed. You can actually change what's being displayed by clicking on this graph setup button down here. This pretty much covers the basic layout and navigation buttons of our Black Box Explorer. Now I'm going to use some of these features to take a look at our 3-inch micro FPV drone baseline tune to see if we should change anything to improve upon its performance. If I find anything that obviously stands out through the use of our Black Box Explorer, I'll go ahead and make the necessary adjustments to my quadcopter's PID and filter settings in Betaflight to see if it improves our flight performance. In this video, I'm not going to do a comprehensive, detailed analysis. I'm just going to introduce you to a few things you might want to look for when trying to improve your quad's performance and show you how really simple yet powerful this free Black Box Explorer tool is that you've been given. So we're going to start with the big picture, and if we need to later in the series, we'll work our way down into the details later. Here we go! So I've opened up my Black Box Explorer software application, and I've opened up my Black Box log file. Now I want to set up my graph to show what flight data I want to look at graphically. Since we set up our filters and PID settings through our PID tuning tab in Betaflight, here's what makes sense to me. Let's graphically look at those settings to see if they're doing their job. First, we'll look at if the filters are doing their job. We do that by setting up our graph to display those things that will show us any noise and vibrations prior to being filtered, as I explained in our first video of this series, and after being filtered. Those things would be our gyro signals from our MPU6000 chip on all three axes, roll, pitch, and yaw, both prior to and after going through the Betaflight filters. Our gyro signal before going through the Betaflight filters is just called gyro underline scaled, which is why we set that up in Betaflight earlier. Our gyro signal after going through the Betaflight filters is called gyro, roll, pitch, and yaw respectively for each of those axes. So let's set up our graph to see those. We go to graph setup, select Add Graph, and from here we want to select Debug, which is the gyro-scaled debug mode we set up earlier in Betaflight. We want gyro-scaled roll for our roll axis, and we also want to show the gyro signal on the roll axis after going through the Betaflight filters, and this is called gyro roll. Similarly, we want the same things for the pitch and yaw axes. Gyro scaled pitch and gyro pitch and gyro scaled yaw and gyro yaw. Then we click Save Changes, and now it shows graphically exactly what we set up. Because I want to use the same graph setup in the future, I'm going to use our shortcut keys of shift and a number between 0 and 9, so we have the ability to save 10 graph setups as templates for future use. I'll just use the number 1. So I just hold down the shift key and the number 1 together, and it saves that graph setup as one of the 10 templates I can save. Then to get back to it, I just press that number, in this case number 1, on my keyboard, and those elements in the template will be shown. To save all of your templates to a file for use with other black box logs, you click Export Workspaces, you name it, and make sure it's saved as a JSON file. Then to use those templates after you load your future black box file of a flight, you also just click on Open Log File / Video, then double click on your saved workspace graphical setup template file, and it loads it for your use. That way you don't have to build these same graphs every time. Now we can scroll to any section of our flight that we're interested in, like this roll. If we hover our mouse over the colored bar, it makes our graph lines thicker and easier for us to see. If we click on this colored bar, it brings up our analyzer display, showing in this case a graph for the amplitude versus frequency of our unfiltered gyro signal on the roll axis. Remember from our first video in the series, we set up our filters to get rid of all of this stuff up here above 100 Hz? So why are we still seeing this? That's because we're looking at the gyro signal before going through the filters we set up. If we now click on this other colored bar over here of our gyro signal showing it after going through the filters, let's see what happens. Wow, look at that. Mostly gone. Looks like our filter setup has worked nicely for the roll axis in terms of getting rid of most of the noise. Let's check it out for the pitch and yaw axes. Here's the pitch axis unfiltered gyro signal. And here's the pitch axis filtered gyro signal. Looks like we've got fairly similar results, And this looks pretty sweet. How about y'all? Unfiltered and filtered. Not bad. I'd like to see more of a smooth curve down here, a smooth exponential decay, but I'm not going to complain too much about this. So I'm fairly happy with the results of our baseline tune filter setup with regards to getting rid of unwanted noise in our gyro signal on all three axes. Now if you have a spike in noise somewhere that isn't getting taken care of by your current filter setup, or the height of your noise floor seems to be a bit high, you may want to consider changing the current settings of the notch filters you've enabled, or even add an additional notch filter to specifically address that particular spike in noise. Before adding any additional filters, however, you might want to take a look at the physical and mechanical features of your build to see if anything's coming loose, if you have a damaged frame, or things like that which you can correct without additional filters. Remember, as you add filtering, you add delay to the response of your quadcopter to your stick inputs. It's in the scope of milliseconds, and at this point we haven't looked at that. So next time, as we look at how our baseline tune PID settings are doing, we can take a look at possibly reducing some filtering, specifically our low-pass filtering, to reduce any possible response delay we come across.
As much as I'd like to continue for the rest of the day, I do value your time, and it's probably a good place to stop for now. So today, I introduced you to your new friend, Blackbox Explorer, showed you how to set up your logging capability on a switch in both your transmitter and Betaflight, and how to use Blackbox Explorer to check out whether or not your filter settings seem to be doing their job to get rid of noise in your gyro signal. Next time, we'll take a look at our baseline PID settings to see if we should change any of those to get better performance out of our micro-FPV quad. Until then, for more good info to speed you on your journey to better FPV fun, make sure to check these out next. Thanks for your time. I'll see you next video. Clear skies, friend.